So I started using canaloplasty, that procedure overall, a couple decades ago. It was a wonderful procedure, technically pretty difficult for some surgeons and took a little bit longer for us too as well, but it did a great job of really reestablishing the natural conventional pathway. One of the most impactful moments of my life was when I realized one day, like a little light bulb went out, when I was looking at a gonio prism preoperatively at a patient. And I was like, wow, look at this beautiful TM. Look at this open angle, it's great. But I was like, wait a minute, where's the resistance? We have no idea preoperatively where the resistance to outflow is. Again, is it the trabecular meshwork? Is it the Schlemm's canal that's collapsed? Or are the distal collector channels not functioning? Are they atrophied? Or are there blockages into the ostia? So whether we do a stent, whether we do, you know, a focal otomy here or there, they all have their places and they do work and I use them all. So because we don't know that, we can hedge our bets by doing a viscodilation, addressing all those points of resistance, the percentage of people who actually get a response. And in my hands with canaloplasty, it's extremely high, which I think is a benefit compared to some of the other technologies that are more segmental or more focal, where we sometimes have great efficacy and sometimes we don't. And that variability can sometimes be because we don't know where the resistance to outflow is. I think what makes canaloplasty, I think, so universal for me is the fact that we can do it. It's approved for standalone, meaning just without cataract surgery alone, or at the time of cataract surgery as well. The cataract surgery portion of it makes a lot of sense because you're taking out the cataract, you're already there. As we all know, patients are happy having their cataract taken care of, and we can still be minimally invasive, open up the conventional pathway. But there's also patients who are standalone, patients who, let's say, are phakic. A younger 50-plus-year-old patient on 3 or 4 medications has mild disease. Well, I can make them suffer and still stay on drops until they get worse and then say, let's do surgery. Or say, you know what, you're telling me you're having symptoms of surface-related issues, right? Fluctuating vision, dry eye. They're having cost issues. They can't remember the medications. They can't physically put it in the eye. All the reasons why we see a poor compliance. Well, instead of waiting until they have significant damage, visual fields or optic nerve damage, let's go ahead and say, let's do a safe procedure, canaloplasty, that doesn't remove tissue, that still allows us to maintain healthy eyes, and gives us the ability to still perform other MIGS procedures later on when they develop a cataract. So I love this procedure in those younger, phakic patients. And then in patients who are pseudophakic, let's say they've already had cataract surgery 10, 15 years ago before we had a lot of MIGS. Those are the same kind of patients who are on 2 or 3 medications who are unhappy with drops. Let's just go ahead and do a canaloplasty. Even if we can get them off of one drop, that can be a significant benefit for a number of our patients. Glaucoma is a long-term progressive disease, and we just do not know which patients will progress or rapidly progress all the time. I tell every patient, I'm on a journey with you, and I'm gonna utilize multiple technologies at different points of that journey to maintain the highest quality of life, but also at the same time, keep protecting you and get those pressures where I want them to be. So keeping the options open for long-term is crucial because we just don't know who's gonna need it as well. So if you shut the door at a 50-year-old patient, what's gonna happen in 25 or 30 years? You're gonna be in trouble potentially. And so that's why it's so important to keep those options open and understand mechanisms of action. You know, I think anybody, no matter what procedure you do, when you make a little opening, can cause some reflux of heme. And I always tell patients, doctors, it's not bleeding. It's just reflux from higher pressure outside the eye, lower pressure inside the eye. But what is unique about canaloplasty, and I do see this clinically, is by viscodilating, not making a significant opening, just a small opening to get in, and viscodilating does tamponade that reflux of heme coming from the episcleral venous system. So to keep that pressurized eye prevents, I think, in my opinion, some reflux of blood. So we tend to see a little bit less of heme or reflux compared to some other procedures. The more you cut, the larger it is, the more, I think, risk you have of intra-op heme, but also post-operatively. You know, a week or two later, some people can breathe too hard, sneeze too hard, squat, and that can cause increase in episcleral venous pressure and cause reflux of heme. So I think having canal dilation with viscoelastic does tamponade, and having a smaller opening limits in some ways that longer term potential for some reflux. I think the beautiful thing about canaloplasty is it's maximizing the outflow pathway. Well, in the conventional pathway, what is our limiting factor? What's our floor? That's the episcleral venous pressure. So to get down to 8 or sub 10, it's not gonna happen. But we do routinely get to the lower to middle teens a lot of times. Data has been published, 3-year data by Mark Ayoto and Dr. Mahmoud Kiami have shown us, we get down to that middle teens routinely on significantly less medications, anywhere from 40 to 60% less meds. So I tell doctors, if your goal is to middle teens, middle to upper teens, you're gonna get there more often than not with canaloplasty, with the reduction of medication burden. most important factor to me is patient selection and expectation and goal setting. Number two is that intraoperatively, making sure that you have a good view. So surgically, making sure you do not compromise on that view. I don't care what MIGS procedure you're doing. Take your time, don't be a hero. Get a good on-fos view. Get yourself comfortable with the amount of viscoelastic in the eye, how much head and scope to tilt, and how much pressure on the gonio prism. The next step is really to make sure that you know your anatomy, right? Making sure you know how to engage the canal. And then when you're doing viscodilation, not to be afraid of actually utilizing the viscodilation properties. Don't be afraid to push more viscoelastic. I say 3 to 4 at least clicks or so of viscoelastic per clock hour. That's about 10 or so, 11 microliters of viscoelastic per every clock hour. That allows us to really flush the entire system out, create those herniations in the TM, and also help the episcleral venous system and help the collector channels open up as well. Having the iTrack Advance with its loading system, I think takes a lot of that kind of manual labor and the uncertainty too of maintaining that good view, takes that into consideration. I think it helps a great deal. Number two, I think it still maximizes all the benefits of the iTrack catheter. The blinking light, the amount of titration, the titratability of visco delivery, I think was something that it allows us to do. And I think for surgeons who are comfortable with that type of procedure, that kind of a loading system with other devices, it's consistent with the other MIGS devices and how we perform other MIGS procedures too. This is my biggest passion. Why am I so passionate about getting people off of medications? It's because we appreciate now more than ever the impact of poor compliance and quality of life. You want happier patients that stay compliant, that number two, have less symptoms of dry eye. And so the question is, what is safer? Is a MIGS procedure like a canaloplasty safer or a drop safer? Majority of the time, I would have said many years ago, drops are safer. And when you look at all the risks of ocular surface disease, meibomian gland dysfunction, with the inflammation, BAK, the preservatives on the trabecular meshwork long-term, on our conjunctiva, on the episcleral venous system, there's a lot of risk with drops over time. If they're not having a good quality of life, and I do not think they're gonna have a good chance of staying on that medication long-term, that person is not controlled in my clinic, regardless of how their pressures are doing, regardless of how their IOP is or their visual fields at that day. They're not controlled if they have a poor quality of life.